of all, I would like to thank organizers that for they care about our thesis. We was a little bit surprised because it's quite new experience for us to try to put to look on the same material from archaeological, historical, and archaeobiological point of view. And the aim of our research was to find any traces of care, of treatment, when you have nearly nothing. To put you inside the context, I need to say some words about the history of medicine in Russia. I should say that we know nearly nothing, because we have a very poor written sources of this kind of information. We have some books in the monasteries, libraries, and that seems that's all that we have. And these books are mainly, it's a translation books from Bulgarian and Greek, from Byzantine culture, and it's these books look like compendium, like encyclopedia, where you can't really understand, is it was this knowledge in use, or it's just a compendium of curiosities or something like that, or modern or general information about the world. And then the reason why we think, and we have nearly nothing material traces of any medical activities, surgery instrument or something like this, mainly because the cultural layers of sites where we work, especially the rural sites, they are plowed during the centuries, and they lose a lot of organic material, so it's very arable cultural layers. That's why it's hard to trace anything which connected with treatment. And you can see, if you read all the text, you understand that the situation which we see in our case, it's very close to things which we speak about from this first part of our meeting. It's mainly the ideas about the medicine, about the illness for medieval people are very complicated. It's mainly the God's punishment or cara Božia, mainly a trick of a devil, but not and somewhere in the lower parts it will be a natural ending of life or just a disease. And to show you how strict was the medical care in medieval Russia, I need to tell some words about the wonderful case about the monk Agapit of Kiev Pechersky Monastery, and he came to the monastery when at last decades of his life, so he has a he was a part of upper class of the medieval society, and he know one of the healer from his unmonked life, and the Armenian physician. And once when Agapit was feel sick, and Armenian physician came to him and tried to help him by the physical normal medicine from our point of view, Agapit said, "Now it can't help me. I just pray it will be healthy," and it works. And a little bit later, this physician was feel sick by himself and tried to escape from his own physician methods, but nothing helps. And only after the praying of Agapit, he was feel himself healthy. And it seems that this idea of spiritual healing as a most reliable way to be healthy is very important for medieval Russian society. In this case, we try to find the one more difficulties on our way, because it's nearly impossible to find any spiritual in this circumstances. But let's focus for a certain case which we are going to show you. It's the preliminary results. It's the results of excavation which was made only in the previous field season, and we didn't finish at all our investigation, but we want to show the first results. We are the place we are going to speak about. It's the very important part of medieval Russia. It's the northeastern part of European part of Russia, of modern European, modern Russia, and it's the region of Suzdal and Rostov. This is the place where, which was a power center, very important political center of the pre-Mongolian Rus of the 10th-12th century. And this region, you can see how dense the settlement structure in this settlement, in this region. All these dots, it's the nearly 400 sites which we find for the last 20 years, and we expect to investigate only, as you can see, only part of this region. And in the time which are in our interest, in the 14th century, this region, the political situation was changed, and this region became a province, but very important economical and agrarian center. And the place which we are going to speak about is when it's a very good example for us, because we know we have some information, historical information about this site. It's this site can be identified as the Mininskaya Silo or Mininskaya Village, which was mentioned in the Ownership Act of the middle of the 15th century, which was given for the previous owner, the part of prince family, to the one of Suzdal monastery. So you can see that this village is very close to the medieval center, to the medieval city. And this site was mentioned more than one time in these written sources corpus, and we know that it declined somewhere in the middle of 16th century and became became a desert settlement, which was still in the use by different agrarian activities, but it wasn't a real settlement as we it wasn't a settled area. And as you can see, all these regions are plowed, and it's helped us to find the settlements and sometimes find a place of cemeteries. This blue spot, it's the place, it's the part of the settled space where we find the human bones in these mixed cultural layers. So we can measure the place of settlement quite cemetery quite reliably. And all these red dots, it's the parts, it's the finds from the settlement cultural layer, so we can see the whole structure, not only the settlement, but the settlement and the cemetery. We know where the people lie after their death and where they live. And this small excavation was around 70 square meters, produced a really good series of graves. You can see that the you can see very dense structure, very more than one layer of graves, quite stable rows. So we can say that we see the normal growth of graveyard. It's no for this excavated part, we can't find any dramatical situation of the life of this graveyard. Have a really good data. It dated really reliable. First of all, because they have nearly nothing of grave goods, only one earring, but the type of this earring for our territory is very good for dating. It's 14th, 15th century. And we make a list of radiocarbon data using the wood from coffins. We have a quite good preservation of some of these graves have quite good preservation of coffins. So we are sure that we are somewhere in the first part of the medieval of the settlement. And if you look on this structure of this Syria, paleodemographical structure, we see that we see a good representative Syria, except it's quite small. But you can see that very important part for us is the predomination of females. We have only 15 adults, but only we are mainly females. And we see very close group. I don't want to tell a lot about this hand because we are quite sure that you catch information quite faster when I say it about them. But you can see that they are very graceful. We have very closed because of these markers. You see that there are quite a lot of them. And the interesting part is that we have a very high, normal, maybe not so dramatical, but still very normal quantity of children's mortality. But you can see that the main ages for when it's 3 and 4 ages, not the newborn. So maybe it can be connected with the changes of diet to go into the adult foods and so on. For women, the main mortality ages, it's most fertilized ages, around 30. And that's important. We have a lot of paleopathology on the skeletons. You can see that if we compare everything, every individual or every adult individuals have more than one paleopathology evidence. But for us, it's important that we are mainly genetic, more than 50%. And it's very interesting for us because for this 15th century, we have a lot of epidemic which fixed in the written sources. But according to our material, we can find them traces in our graveyard. Just to prove what we was very careful with our materials. And one skeleton is really interesting. We have a grave, a female grave, with the huge tumor on the skulls. And we try to make a lot about as much as possible to understand the disease of this person. And according to the materials, to the we can show that it's not a cancer. And it seems that we see the Gardner syndrome, one more time, epigenetic paleopathology. And it shows, and she has a lot of pathologies, not only Gardner syndrome, and she is quite old for this series. If we try to resolve everything, we can see that our group of people looks very ill. And according to well-known phenomenon of astrological paradox, when we have healthy but diet people, we can say that we have sick but quite alive people. And how we can do, we live quite a lot. And how we can, find any decision of this situation, of this paradox. And if we look at the material culture of this settlement from these surface finds which I showed you in the beginning, we can see that the welfare of this ordinary peasants, these close groups, has very normal for Russian rural communities features. So we know that it's not somewhere of the upper class, but it's ordinary settlers of the settlement. We can see that they are quite welfare. They have a lot of coins in their lives. We have that part of bronze murals, which came from the lower parts of Volga region, from Zlatoye Orda. It's something which they certainly can buy. They can't produce it. We have a series of locks and keys. So it's impossible to explain way. Oh, it's not only the part of this finds. And we see that it's normal for this settlement. I'm very close to the end. If we look at this settlement start their life before it's mentioned in the written sources, somewhere in the end of the 11th century, and we see that welfare, which we can trace in the 14th century, is normal for this settlement. Because for the 12th century settlement, we can find the fences, which are quite rare on the fences between the households, which are quite rare on this settlement, and show the higher level of ideas of property for this medieval settlers. We see the rich collections of artifacts. So, for our point of view, the only way to explain this paradox sick but quite alive. It's the thinking that they treat about themselves. It's not a problem for them to save this life for this community. Thank you.